Welfare programs provide assistance to those in need and are a central part of government services. Yet they have been at the center of a long-standing debate. While supporters defend them as a vital lifeline for vulnerable populations, critics argue they act as a crutch by perpetuating dependency and preventing recipients from achieving self-sufficiency. So, which is it? Do welfare programs help you or hold you back? This paper sheds light on this question by studying the Supplemental Security Income Program. SSI is the largest cash welfare program in the US and pays around $50 billion each year to 8 million individuals, of which 1.3 million are children. Recipients qualify for benefits if they can provide evidence of a disability that prevents them from working or inhibits their performance in school. Mirroring the broader welfare debate, critics argue that this discourages children and young adults from pursuing educational and professional success because doing so would jeopardize their SSI eligibility. This suggests that removing individuals from the program could actually improve their outcomes in the long run by freeing them of these perverse incentives. To investigate this, the author studies individuals who qualified for SSI as children, but who were removed from the program at age 18 due to a failure to qualify under the adult standards. Because of differences in how disability is defined for adults versus children, approximately 40% of SSI children lose their benefits at this juncture. Note that individuals who are removed at age 18 are likely to differ systematically from those who successfully re-qualify for the program as adults. Thus, a simple comparison between these groups conflates the causal impact of being removed from SSI with the effects of these underlying differences. To overcome this obstacle, the author exploits a policy change enacted as part of welfare reform in 1996. Prior to that point, SSI children rarely underwent a medical review at age 18, and even those that did, were allowed to continue on the program as adults as long as they did not demonstrate any medical improvement. After 1996, however, all children were required to undergo an age 18 review, and only those satisfying the stricter adult disability standard were allowed to continue on the program. Crucially, these stricter requirements only apply to children with an 18th birthday after August 22, 1996, the date on which welfare reform was enacted. This figure illustrates the effect of this policy change. The x-axis shows the date of the child's 18th birthday, with the vertical line drawn at the August 22, 1996 cutoff. Each point represents the fraction of children with a birthday in the corresponding week who received an age 18 review. For those who turned 18 before the cutoff, the probability of receiving a review was essentially zero. On the other side, however, nearly 90% of children with an 18th birthday after the cutoff did receive a review. Correspondingly, there is also a sharp increase in the probability of being removed from SSI. Despite the fact that these two groups are unlikely to differ systematically in any way, except for the fact that their birthdays happen to fall just on either side of this cutoff, individuals to the right, call this the treatment group, were 39 percentage points more likely to receive an unfavorable review and be removed from the program relative to individuals just on the left, call this the control group. This figure shows the probability of being enrolled in SSI for individuals in the treatment group relative to the control. Prior to turning 18, there is no measurable difference between the two groups, and this persists up to 2 years after the child's 18th birthday due to administrative lags. At that point, however, the gap in enrollment balloons as treatment individuals are kicked off the program. Over time, this gap gradually shrinks as control individuals subsequently leave the program for other reasons. So, what happens to these treated individuals? Does being removed from SSI allow them to flourish in the long term as they are freed from the program's constraints? In short, the answer is no. This figure mirrors the previous one and shows how income evolves for the treatment group relative to the control group in the years following their 18th birthday. As expected, average SSI income declines sharply as individuals are removed from the program, and the author does find a compensating increase in employment earnings. This indicates that, in response to losing their SSI benefits, individuals are, in fact, working more. However, the magnitude of this increase is dwarfed by the loss in SSI benefits. On average, individuals who are removed from the program are able to recover just one-third of their lost SSI income. On net, and after aggregating with all other observable income, total income falls substantially as a result of being removed from the program. To put this more concretely, the author finds that on average, individuals who lose their benefits increase their annual employment earnings by $3,000. The average loss in SSI income, however, is $7,800, and overall, there is a decline in total observed income of $5,700. Over the 16 years following removal from the program, this amounts to a loss of $76,000 in present discounted terms. Moreover, the author also finds that SSI removal leads to a substantial increase in income volatility. This suggests that SSI and other welfare programs increase the well-being of their recipients not just by providing an additional source of income, but also by providing a stable and guaranteed source of income that is not subject to unforeseen shocks, such as reductions in hours or job loss. So, in conclusion, this paper finds no evidence that SSI holds recipients back from self-sufficiency, or that revoking their benefits would lead to higher income in the long run. Instead, removal leads to a large decline in income, and removes the insurance provided by a stable income. In this context, it does not appear to be the case that welfare inhibits success. As always, you can check out the full paper, along with its references to other related research. These include papers studying the labor supply effects of other welfare programs, including disability insurance, Medicaid, and food stamps, as well as a literature on earnings and household income volatility in the US.